السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، أما بعد. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Him Azza wa Jal to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. I see all the children have come and they're waiting for the surprise. What happened? Shaykh has started the talk. It'll be right after the talk, inshallah. Okay, so you all have to remain until then, alright? Okay. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to continue the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and we're going to do our level best to end it today inshallah. Because the thing with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is that he is the most mentioned prophet in the noble Quran. Because I'm sure, as you all are aware, when you look at his story, we know about the father of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. We know about the mother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. We know about his brother Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. We know about his sister, the sister who the mother sent to go and check on Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. We know about the birth of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, about the upbringing of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, about the miracles of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So his story is in a lot of detail in the noble Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned his story in a lot of detail in the noble Quran. And I myself, even though the story has spanned across 4 days, I haven't in reality touched it in its entirety. I have been concise, summarizing and making it in a very concise manner to be able to, cover the story as soon as possible, so that we can move on to the other prophets as well, inshallah ta'ala. So now we left Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Banu Israel as they were on their way towards Baytul Maqdis. They are on their way towards Baytul Maqdis. Allah Azza wa Jal, He commands the Banu Israel, يَا قَوْمِ دُخُلُوا الْأَرْضَ الْمُقَدَّسَةَ الَّتِي كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَلَا تَرْتَدُّوا عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِكُمْ فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ. In the sense, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions what Musa alayhi salatu wasalam instructed his people. Oh my people, enter udukhulu al-ardha al-muqaddasa, enter the sacred, the blessed land of Palestine. الَّذِي كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for you all. وَلَا تَرْتَدُوا عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِكُمْ, and do not turn back, don't flee from that land, don't turn back in flight. فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ, for if you do that, you will be turned back as losers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. But then you know what they said? Being Banu Israel, they looked at Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and they said, قَالُوا يَا مُوسَى إِنَّ فِيهَا قَوْمًا جَبَّارِينَ. Oh Musa, when we look at this land, it's sacred and all of that, but then it looks like there are people of, great strength, like tyrants who are ruling the land, قَوْمًا جَبَّارِينَ. وَإِنَّا لَنْ نَدْخُلَهَا, and we shall not enter it, حَتَّى يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا, until those Qawm Jabbarin leave the lands, we are not going to enter this particular land. And after they leave, we will enter. And this was their reply or response to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And then they went on to, exaggerate that, and they responded in an even more rude manner. They said, O Musa, فَذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ, because Musa alayhi salatu wasalam kept insisting and urging them forward, because this is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They forgot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped them against the greatest tyrant of that time, Fir'aun, and they were worried about petty tyrants within the land of Palestine after having defeated Fir'aun. They forgot the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them. So they looked at Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and said, Ya Musa, فَذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ, you and your Lord go, فَقَاتِلَا, both of you go and fight, إِنَّ هَاهُنَا قَائِدُونَ, we're just going to sit back and relax over here. We're going to relax, you and your Lord go and fight them, and after they have been destroyed, just inform us and we'll come in and settle in the lands of Palestine. Look at how their response, after all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had conferred upon them, after all the blessings that they had witnessed, the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala they had witnessed, they still went on to respond or retort to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam in such a rude manner. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he raises his hands, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي لَا أَمْلِكُ إِلَّا نَفْسِهِ وَأَخِي فَافْرُقْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays, Ya Allah, Rabbi, inni la amliku illa nafsi wa akhi. I have no control except over myself and my brother. In the sense, my authority. These people, they're not listening to me. Myself and my brother, we are ready to go ahead. But, you know, the qawm, the Bani Israel, they're not listening to me. Fafruq baynana wa baynana qawm al-fasiqin. So, let there be a distinction between us and between the nation that is disobedient unto you, i.e. the Banu Israel. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to enter the lands of Palestine, but they refused. And because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them. And how did He do that? Allah azza wa jal, He mentions in the Noble Quran, قَالَ فَإِنَّهَا مُحَرَّمَةٌ عَلَيْهِمْ 40 سَنَةً. Okay, so you don't want to enter the promised land, the land that Allah has decreed for you all, you don't want to enter it, so be it, it is haram, it shall be forbidden upon you all for 40 years. For 40 years you will not be able to enter that land, and for 40 years you will all yatihuna fil ard. For 40 years you will wander throughout the land, you will wander all around the place for 40 years. This is the punishment upon the Bani Israel. فَلَا تَأْسَ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. So do not be sad or don't grieve over a people who are fasiqoon, who are rebellious and disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, for a period of 40 years, the Banu Israel, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, and the believers and the others as well, all of them, this was a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the Banu Israel. They could not enter the lands of Palestine. Instead, it was made haram upon them to enter, and they began to wander around the land. In the sense, they started going in circles. They would start at one point, and they would end up at that point. After a long journey, they would come back to the same point. They started to wander. For 40 years, this took place. And during that period, even though it was a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal yet blessed them with so many things, such as, for example, man and salwa. Because they were hungry, they didn't have food, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with something known as man and salwa. And He mentions in the Noble Quran, وَقَطَّعْنَاهُمُ اثْنَتَيْ عَشْرَةَ أَسْبَاطًا أُمَمًا وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَى إِذِ اسْتَسْقَاهُ قَوْمُهُ أَنِ اضْرِبْ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرَ فَانْبَجَسَتْ مِنْهُ اثْنَتَا عَشْرَةَ عَيْنًا قَدْ عَلِمَ كُلُّ أُنَاسٍ مَشْرَبَهُمْ وَظَلَّلْنَا عَلَيْهِمُ الْغَمَامَ وَأَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَنَّ وَالسَّلْوَى كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ وَمَا ظَلَمُونَا وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states, we divided them into 12 tribes as distinct nations, the Banu Israel, and then وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَى. We directed Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, we informed Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, إِذِ اسْتَسْقَاهُ قَوْمُ, when his people ask him for water, when the Banu Israel ask you for water, O Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, اِذْرِبْ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرِ. There was a specific rock that he was supposed to hit with his stick, with his asa, he was supposed to hit that rock, اِذْرِبْ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرِ فَانْبَجَسَتْ مِنْ هُثْنَتَا عَشْرَةَ عَيْنًا. 12 springs of water broke forth, and each tribe, they had their own spring of water to quench their thirst. It was a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a never-ending spring for them to quench their thirst. And Allah goes on to state, وَظَلَّلْنَا عَلَيْهِمُ الْغَمَامِ. We shaded them with the clouds, because they were in the middle of a desert, and they were roaming around for 40 years. During that period, Allah states, we shaded them with the clouds, وَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَنَّ وَالسَّلْوَى. And we sent down upon them al-man and as-salwa. Now what is al-man and as-salwa? Scholars of tafsir go on to mention that al-man Like Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he states that Al-Man used to descend on trees. It used to come down on trees. In the morning when they used to wake up, just as how we have morning dew on the trees and plants, they used to find this blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala known as Man all over the trees. It would cover the trees. All they had to do is just go and pluck it off the trees. It used to be like a sweet gum, in a sense like flour. They could, you know, make different things out of that, and they used to eat. It was known as Man. And as for Salwa, the scholars of Tafsir, they mention that it is a bird similar to the bird quail. You know, that small quail bird, which looks like a little small chicken. This was the bird that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down. So they had enough food, enough water to help them survive during that period where they were wandering around. This was a punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them. In another narration from the scholars of Tafsir, they state that Al-Man used to descend on them like the descending of snow. Just like snow comes down, Man used to descend on them. And just as how you see in countries where it snows, you see the trees all covered with white snow. Likewise, the trees used to be covered with Man. And all they had to do is in the morning wake up, go and take it off the trees, and they could keep it, they could eat it as much as they want. It used to be whiter than milk and sweeter than honey. It used to be whiter than milk, sweeter than honey. Now, the thing with Bani Israel is, in general, they were a very ungrateful nation. There are even other reports from the scholars of Tafsir that even their clothes, they didn't necessarily have to go buy clothes, etc. Another favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them was that their clothes used to grow with them. Their clothes used to grow with them. This is not mentioned in the Quran or the Hadith, but this is from the books of Tafsir and history. Their clothes used to grow with them, in the sense they didn't have to, buy branded clothes and things like that. Things were so much more easier at that time. You don't have to cook. Man and salwa comes, you get up in the morning, just go, take the man, you eat it, you're done. The bird comes, quail, you get your meat, alhamdulillah. You go to the spring, you've got fresh water, that's sorted out too. But they were a very ungrateful nation. They were a very ungrateful nation, and then they started to complain to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, man and salwa is boring. Man and salwa is boring. Every day waiting, man, every day salwa, salwa. Now we want something different. And then they go to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and they say, we want fumiha, adasiha, wa basaliha, we want garlic, we want onions, we want chili, we want this, we want dal. They even ask for dal. And we eat dal till today. They wanted dal as well. They went and asked Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, lentils, we want all of this. Fine. Qala atastabdiluna alladhi huwa adna billadhi huwa khair. Do you really want to exchange, that which is good with something inferior? You're getting man and salwa from the heavens. You want to change that for something that you want to cultivate and grow from the ground, from the dirt? By all means, be my guest, go ahead. So, man and salwa was stopped, and they were asked to cultivate, and then they started to grow. What? Potatoes, tomatoes, onions, chilies, dal, and whatnot. And until today, we are cultivating because of that. If not, scholars of Tafsir mention, if they hadn't grumbled, if they hadn't complained, we would have man and salwa until today. We would have man and salwa until today. Just amazing, But they hastened and they wanted to barter something inferior with that which they had, which was something so good. And in the end, the deal went sour for them at the end of the day. And they had to cultivate, they had to go through all the hardship, they had to toil and strive to, grow their own food, their own cultivation. This is all mentioned in regard to the Banu Israel. So during that period, there's another very important incident that took place. And this was between Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and an individual by the name Khadir. But the thing is, I'm not going to go into that story today. Inshallah ta'ala, maybe after Ramadan, I will come to the Maldives specifically for that, inshallah, and we'll have a dedicated lecture for that. Because we've just got one more day, most probably tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala. So we have to try and cover the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam as well. So we will move swiftly. A little in regard to Khadir alayhi salatu wasalam, before we move further, there's a difference of opinion amongst the scholars as to who Khadir was. Was he a prophet? Was he a righteous man? There are even some who go on to say that he was an angel. But the more favorable opinion is that he was a prophet from the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wallahu alam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There's enough and more proof to prove the fact that he was a prophet. Like say, for example, the certain things that he did, the certain things that he did, he could not have done those things except by command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and unless he was a prophet. Like say for example, he even killed a little boy. Yeah, and he had his own reasons, but no ordinary individual can do that. No ordinary, however righteous a person can be, he can't say, oh, today I woke up in the morning, I was inspired to kill so and so. No one can say that. But the Prophets, alayhi salatu wasalam, they can, because they receive wahi, they receive divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So based on that and many other things as well, the majority of the scholars, they favor the opinion that he was a prophet who existed during the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, but he was sent to a different nation, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, to Banu Israel. Now this all started one day when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was addressing the people. He was addressing the people, and one individual got up from the crowd and asked Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, "Ya Musa, who do you think is the most knowledgeable person on the face of this earth?" At that point, at that given time, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, without hesitating, he assumed that he being the Prophet of Allah, he being the one who had directly spoken to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had to be the most knowledgeable person, because there were certain things that only he had access to, because he was the one speaking directly to Allah, he was the Prophet of Allah, and he did not know about Fadil. So based on those assumptions, he quickly replied saying, "I am the most knowledgeable person on the face of this earth." So because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach Musa alayhi salatu wasalam certain things, an important lesson. So and Allah azza wa jal instructed Musa alayhi salatu wasalam saying, there is this slave of mine, in Surah Al-Kahf, the story is mentioned in beautiful detail, there is this slave of mine who has been given a blessing from me, knowledge from me, go to him. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, from this we understand, being a very keen student, a humble student, he immediately, you know, retracted his statement and he left on a journey to go study by Khadir alayhi salatu wasalam, a beautiful story which we shall discuss on another date inshallah ta'ala. Now moving on, so this particular incident also took place during the time when the Banu Israel were roaming around, during that 40 years, okay? Now the 40 years are coming to an end, and Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is also getting closer to meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the sense, not the usual meetings, he is about to pass away from this world. And now, because he knows that he's going to pass away, he feels it, he wishes to die by Baytul Maqdis. He wishes to die by Baytul Maqdis. And he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Scholars mentioned that this dua of his was answered. And he, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, passed away just a stone's throw away from Baytul Maqdis. They were granted entry into Baytul Maqdis, in the sense, not completely, because later on, after the death of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, it was with Yusha ibn Nun, one of the followers of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, a young boy who accompanied Musa alayhi salatu wasalam when he set out to meet Khadir, this individual, Yusha ibn Nun. They, at the Banu Israel, they actually entered Palestine in a Baytul Maqdis with Yusha ibn Nun. But Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he passed away very close to Baytul Maqdis, by the border of Palestine. This is where Musa alayhi salatu wasalam passed away. An interesting incident that took place when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was about to pass away was the fact that the angel of death came to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is mentioned in the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The angel of death came to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and wanted to take his soul. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, being Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he gave the angel of death one blow. He punched him. Angel of death went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, he actually wanted the angel of death to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for an extension. He wanted an extension. Scholars rahimahumullah explain, not that he did not want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wanted to do more good deeds. There are many reasons. He wanted to perhaps get the Banu Israel to Palestine. There are many reasons why he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for an extension. And that was given to him, in the sense, a choice was given to him, where the angel of death comes back to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and says, "Oh Musa, you have been instructed to rub your hand on the back of a cow, on the back of an animal, and the amount of hairs that touch your body, on the body of an animal, the amount of hairs that touch your body, for every hair, you will get an extension of 1 year in your life." Amazing, isn't it? I mean, just say you were, if there were 100 hairs, that if you have a palm were to touch 100 hairs, you would get 100 years. You would get 1 century of an extension. Amazing. 1,000 hairs, then 10 centuries. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, after hearing what the angel of death, you know, this proposal the angel of death put forward, he asked the angel of death, okay, what after that? What after that? Say if I were to be given 100 years extension, what after that? The angel of death said, inevitably I will come again to take your soul, be it 100 years or 1,000 years, anyway you have to pass away. Then Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said, what is the point? Rather take my soul now. I wish to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he passes away. So after the death of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, many brothers and sisters in Islam, there are other prophets as well. And because time does not permit, and very sadly the month of Ramadan is coming to an end, it just flew away from us. An amazing month of Ramadan. I had a really good time here in your beautiful country, alhamdulillah. But I would like to inform you that there are other prophets, because I wouldn't want you to think that these are the only prophets that we, you know, discuss. There are prophets like, say for example, Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam, Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam. We'll talk a little about Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam, but his story is in great detail as well. Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. There are other prophets that we need to discuss about. So inshallah ta'ala, the plan is after the month of Ramadan, I hope to come in about a month or two, we will have another extension of the messengers series inshallah ta'ala, during weekdays perhaps. Don't worry, we will announce it, and if you don't mind, you can like my page and you will get the updates inshallah on social media. And then the brothers here will also do their work in terms of spreading the word. So you can please come and be a part of these events and gain knowledge in regard to the other Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. Now for today, we move on to another great prophet from the Ulul Azm. I thought it very important to touch on all the Ulul Azm, and alhamdulillah we have done that. I mentioned, I think, in the first session, who are the Ulul Azm? Starting off in a chronological order, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Some brothers asked me whether I would touch on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, to talk about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, I need 2 Ramadan. To talk about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, I need 2 months of Ramadan. For the Meccan period and the Medina period, I need 2 months of Ramadan. We'll plan a series for that inshallah in the upcoming years. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all to attain many more Ramadan. Ameen. Okay, so now we're going to talk about Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. But before we delve into the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, we need to talk about his mother, Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. So in regard to Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, she belonged to the family known as Al-Imran. Now they were from the Banu Israel. A little about Zakaria and Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. If you are not aware of this, the Banu Israel, they killed Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam, and they killed Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. They were the ones who killed Zakaria and Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. So they were from the Banu Israel. Because when you analyze the family tree of the prophets, you will come to an understanding, a realization, that most of the prophets, they took the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam, you know. And the only prophet I would say on this side through the lineage of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam was none other than our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And that is one of the reasons why they have so much of animosity towards us, because they took the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent so many prophets through their lineage. I'm talking about the Jews and the Christians. They took it for granted. That's all these prophets came through their lineage, the Banu Israel. From Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Starts off where? Ya'qub. We said Israel was another name for Ya'qub. Israel means Abdullah, slave of Allah, because Eel in their language, in the Hebrew language, means Allah, Eel. So Israel, like Mikael, Jibreel, you know, Jibreel, Eel at the end means Allah. So Jibreel, you can translate Jibreel as Abdullah, as slave of Allah, as the chosen one of Allah, you know, as the beloved slave of Allah, different meanings. Israel, Mikael, Jibreel, Israel. You understand? So all these meanings are very much similar. They all, you know, somehow come to the meaning of Abdullah. So nevertheless, they are all from that same lineage. So we have Zakaria and Yahya. Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam, his son was Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. So they were all part of Al-Imran, the family of Imran. And this family was a special family, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed a surah itself talking about, in the sense titled as Surah Al-Imran. You understand? The third surah in the Noble Quran after Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Imran. So in that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the family of Imran. And also Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the Noble Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the family of Imran. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal chose them over mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. Indeed, Allah chose Adam. Allah chose Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah chose the family of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah chose the family of Imran over alameen, over the mankind and the jinn kind of their times. During their time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them all to be the best of nations. During our time, obviously, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best of creation. And we, the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are the best of nations. Okay, so now the wife of Imran, the wife of Imran, her name was, according to the scholars of tafsir, her name was Hanna bint Qafudha. Hanna bint Qafudha. Hanna, the daughter of Qafudha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about her in the Noble Quran, in Surah Al-Imran. إِذْ قَالَتْ إِمْرَأَةُ عِمْرَانَ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِهِ مُحَرَّرًا فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Remember when the wife of Imran, this lady Hanna, إِذْ قَالَتْ إِمْرَأَةُ عِمْرَانَ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِهِ مُحَرَّرًا. Oh Allah, I have vowed to you the child who is in my womb to be dedicated for your services. She wasn't actually blessed with a child for a long period of time, and she prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, if you bless me with a child, I will dedicate that child, because she, you know, was wishing for a baby boy. So she intended, Ya Allah, if I'm blessed with a child, I will dedicate that child unto your services. He will be completely, you know, in the mission of spreading the teachings of Islam, spreading the teachings of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will dedicate him for your services. So this is a vow she took, and she had this strong intention to do so, and then she prays to Allah, فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي, so accept it from me, O Allah, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ, verily you are the all-hearer, the all-knowing. She prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what happens? She gives birth. فَلَمَّا وَضَعَتْهَا قَالَتْ رَبِّ إِنِّي وَضَعْتُهَا أُنْثَى. She gives birth. And she gives birth, not to a baby boy, but she gives birth to a beautiful baby girl. She gives birth to a beautiful baby girl. And then she says, رَبِّ إِنِّي وَضَعْتُهَا أُنْثَى. Oh Allah, I have given birth to a female child. I have delivered a female child, because she was worried now. She has already intended that she will send her child, she's going to dedicate her child under the services of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was not a practice to do that with female children at that time. It was generally male children. They used to say, because she'll have to stay in the masjid and, you know, devote her life for the worship and service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now she has delivered a female child. She is telling this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And obviously Allah knew about this, as it's mentioned in the Noble Quran, Wallahu a'lamu bima wada'at. Allah knows what she has given birth. But she, because of her intention, she informs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she says, وَلَيْسَ ذَكَرُكَ الْأُنْثَى. And the male is not like the female. The female is not like the male. Islam, we all believe that, you know, we are all equal creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we males and females, we are not identical. We may be equal, but we are not identical. So that's what she was highlighting here. وَلَيْسَ ذَكَرُكَ الْأُنْثَى. The male is not identical to the female, nor is the female identical to the male. وَإِنِّي سَمَّيْتُهَا مَرْيَمْ. And I name her Maryam. وَإِنِّي أُعِيذُهَا بِكَ وَذُرِّيَّتَهَا مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And O Allah, I seek refuge with you for her and for her offspring from Shaytan. According to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever a child is born, Shaytan comes and kind of pinches the child. The devil comes and pinches the child, and that's why the child starts crying. But here she prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the devil should not touch Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam or her child we will discuss inshallah ta'ala. Allah answered her dua and the devil did not touch Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam nor the child of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. According to the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, hadith is in Tirmidhi, Ali radiallahu anhu makes mention. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam is reported to have said, خَيْرُ نِسَائِهَا مَرْيَمْ بِنْتُ إِمْرَانِ وَخَيْرُ نِسَائِهَا خَدِيجَةُ بِنْتُ خُوَيْلِ. The best woman of her time, during her time, was Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, Maryam bint Imran. And the best woman of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam's time was Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha. So Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, because her mother had intended to dedicate her to the services of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from a very young age, she grew up under that tarbiyah, under the upbringing of her mother. And in general, the angels, she was a child, people around her used to witness so many things, so many miraculous things, and they knew that there's something special about her. There's just something so special about Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. She's just not an ordinary human being. The angels used to come to her, command her, and urge her, Ya Maryam qunuti li rabbiki wasjudi warka'i ma'a raki'in. The angels used to come to her and say, Oh Maryam, Ya Maryam, uqunuti li rabbik. Submit yourself with obedience to your Lord. Wasjudi, make excessive sajda. Warka'i, and bow down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ruku with the ones who bow down unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bellahu ma fi samawati wal ard. And to him belongs all that is in the heavens and the earth. Kullu lahu qanitun. And everything surrenders with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, because she was growing up like this, and now her mother had intended to, like I said, you know, dedicate her to the services of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she had to go and stay in Baytul Maqdis. Now there had to be someone to look after her because she was a female. She was a young girl, a lady at that time. There had to be someone to look after her. Now she was the daughter of Imran, like we mentioned. So there were many from the religious scholars at that time, the religious leaders at that time, who wanted to, you know, look after Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. They took it upon themselves as a privilege, as an honor, to look after Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. So at a given point of time, there was actually a dispute that took place amongst the leaders, amongst the religious leaders, amongst the scholars, to look after Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam during her stay at Baytul Maqdis. There was a huge dispute, and then comes about Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam, who, according to some scholars, was her uncle. He was her maternal uncle. He comes forward and he says, I will look after her. But then the other leaders, they all said, she is the daughter of Imran. Imran, who was our imam, because Imran used to be an imam for all of them. He used to be the leader for all of them. So they said, no, we want to have the privilege to look after her. So scholars of tafsir, like Ibn Kathir rahimahullah and others, mentioned that they actually, drew lots. In the sense, they used to have pens, they used to have something similar to wood, they used to have pens made of something similar to wood. So what they did was, they went to a particular river, and this was the way they used to cast lots. Today, you know, you have different ways of casting lots. Like, for example, you can write your name in pieces of paper and, you know, you can shuffle it all up and somebody can pick it up and, you know, your name can come forward. You know, you have different ways of casting lots. During their time, what they did was, all of the religious leaders, they went by the river and they all threw their pens into the river. So the system was, if whichever pen surfaced, the owner of that pen will look after Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. So what happened? The river basically took all the pens. The only pen that remained on the surface was the pen of Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam. So this was taken as a message for them that it is the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the decree of Allah azza wa jal, that Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam should look after Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. So now this begins, Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, she begins her time, she begins spending her time at Baytul Maqdis, and she used to indulge in excessive ibadah, excessive worship, like we just mentioned, because the angels used to encourage her and, you know, command her to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam, he started to notice amazing things happening around Maryam عليه الصلاة والسلام. الله عز وجل mentions once again in Surah Al Imran, فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted her with goodly acceptance, and He made her grow up in a very good manner, and He put her under the care of Zakariya. وَكَفَّلَهَا زَكَرِيَّا. He put her under the care of Zakariya. كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَّا الْمِحْرَابَ وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا. And whenever Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam used to enter the mihrab, mihrab in the sense there was a place, a kind of a niche where she used to offer her prayers, a small room like an area in Baitul Maqdis where she used to spend most of her time worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever he used to come and visit her with food, provisions, he would find something amazing. During the seasons of winter, she would have fruits of spring. And during the seasons of spring and summer, she would have fruits of winter. So he would ask her, أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا؟ قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمُ أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا؟ Oh Maryam, where are you getting all this from? And she would very calmly reply, قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. She would reply, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who provides rizq, sustenance to whom He wills, بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Without a limit, without a limit. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who provides rizq. So she was an individual blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many, many ways. And then there was a point where the angels started to give her amazing glad tidings. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. And remember when the angels said, O Maryam, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen you. Look, in Allah astafaki, Allah has chosen you, watahharaki, and then purified you, wastafaki, and again chosen you, ala nisa'il alameen, over the women of mankind at that given time. Allahu Akbar. So the angels used to encourage her to do more and more good deeds, and she was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night. Scholars of Tafsir mentioned she used to spend the nights in ibadah, she used to fast during the day. She was an individual who indulged in so much of ibadah. She was completely at the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now something amazing happens. One day she goes out to relieve herself. Okay, now we shift to Surah Maryam, because in the Noble Quran we have a complete surah titled as Maryam, a beautiful surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah talks about Isa alayhi salatu wasalam in that particular surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَاذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمِ إِذِ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْطِيًّا. And mention in the book, and remember in the book, okay, وَاذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمِ, the story of Maryam عليه الصلاة والسلام. إِذِ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْطِيًّا. And remember when she withdrew in seclusion from where she was, okay, from where she was to a place facing east. Now what happened was one day she left Baitul Maqdis and she went out to relieve herself. She went outside to relieve herself. فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِن دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا. She placed a screen to screen herself, okay, to cover herself when she was relieving herself. And then Allah mentions, فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا. We sent to her our ruh, in other words, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Just as we have in Surah Al-Qadr, what? وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر تنزل الملائكة والروح. The angels descend and the ruh. Who is the ruh? Jibreel عليه الصلاة والسلام. فأرسلنا إليها روحنا فتمثل لها بشرا سويا. We sent to her the ruh, that is Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, and فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا. He appeared before her in the form of a man, in the guise of a human being. He didn't come in his true form, he came in the guise of a human being. So she was about to relieve herself and she notices a man. in the far distance. She notices a man and then she sternly looks at him and says, قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا. She looks at him and she says, verily I seek refuge with the most beneficent, with the most beneficent and the most merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أعوذ بالرحمن منك, from you, إن كنت تقيا. If you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, stay away. She was admonishing him because she did not know who he was. He came in the form of a man. Now this angel, in other words, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he reassures Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam by saying, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَسُولُ رَبِّكِ لِأَهَبَ لَكِ غُلَامًا زَكِيًّا. Don't worry, I am only a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَسُولُ رَبِّكِ. I am a messenger from your Lord. And I have come to announce, to give you glad tidings of a غُلَامًا زَكِيًّا, of a righteous son. I have come to inform you, I have come to give you glad tidings of a righteous son. Now Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, being such a chaste, innocent and pure lady, the first thing that crossed her mind was, how can I be blessed with a son? Because she had never ever even thought of marriage at that time, nor had she even seen a man properly at that time. She was so pure, she was so innocent, you know, she hadn't even literally seen a man properly at that time. So she, out of amazement, she asked, قَالَتْ أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي قالت أنى يكون لي غلام ولم يمسسني بشر ولم أك بغيا. She asks, how can I have a son when no man has touched me, nor am I, you know, in a way, nor am I bad or unchaste in any manner. How am I to have a son? And then this angel informs her, قَالَ كَذَلِكِ قَالَ رَبُّكِ هُوَ عَلَيَّ هَيِّنِ. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he informs her, it will be so because your Lord, قَالَ كَذَلِكِ قَالَ رَبُّكِ, because your Lord said, هُوَ عَلَيَّ هَيِّنِ, it is something easy for me. Obviously it is easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does what he wills. وَلِنَجْعَلَهُ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَرَحْمَةً مِنَّا. And we wish to appoint him, who? Her son, as a sign to mankind, wa rahmatan minna, and as a mercy from us, wa kana amram maqdiya. And it is a matter that has been decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a matter that has been decided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now what happens? She becomes pregnant. She becomes pregnant because this was the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And people now started to notice. People started to notice that she had become pregnant, and they started to ask her questions, and they started to, you know, question her innocence, and they used to put forward all kinds of questions. They used to ask her, Ya Maryam, can a tree grow without the seed being planted by someone? Is it possible for a tree? You know, it was a hypothetical or metaphorical question that they asked. How can a tree grow without someone planting the seed? Is it possible? So she replied, okay, if that's the case, who planted the first seed? Who planted the first seed? Now there's obviously it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they ask her, okay, how can a child be born without the involvement of a male? Because they started to suspect her. They started to think bad about her. And that's why they asked all these questions. How can a child be born without the involvement of a male? Because they thought she had, you know, indulged in that, you know, something that is haram. So she said, okay, so then how was the first human being created? He was created without the involvement of a male or a female. Who was that? Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So they were left without any response at the end of the day. But then what they did was they started to spread false rumors about Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam around the town, around the city. They started to talk bad about Al Imran. They started to talk bad about Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam, because many of the rumors were about him, that he had perhaps indulged in something haram with Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. But in reality that was never the case, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us of the true story. She was pure, she was innocent, and she was chaste. She was blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a son. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she was blessed by Allah with a son without the involvement of a male. So then she went on to inform them of the glad tidings she had received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he mentions in the noble Quran, إِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ اسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحُ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمُ وَجِيهًا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وجيها في الدنيا والآخرة ومن المقربين. She informed them, and remember when the angel said, Ya Maryam, O Maryam, inna Allaha yubashiruki. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives you glad tidings, bi kalimatim min husmuhu al-Masih, with a word. A word in the sense Allah said be, Allah said kun, and she became pregnant, you know. So that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His name is Al-Masih, Isa ibn Maryam, wajihan fi dunya wal akhirah wa min al-muqarrabin. He will be held in honor in this world as well as in the hereafter, and he will be of those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the date of her delivery draws near. Some scholars, rahimahumullah, state that it was a usual pregnancy period that she went through. It was 9 months. Some say it was 8 months. Some say it even happened much faster. In a couple of months, she gave birth. This was also another miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Surah Maryam, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, فَحَمَلَتْهُ فَانْتَبَذَتْ بِهِ مَكَانًا قَصِيًّا. So now she moves a little further away from where she was. She moves to Bethlehem, Baitul Laham. She moves to Bethlehem, Baitul Laham, which is about 10-15 kilometers away from where she was. And by a river, she gives birth. She gives birth to her son, the son that had been promised to her by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions what happened at that point. فَأَجَاءَهَا الْمَخَاضُ إِلَىٰ جِذْعِ النَّخْلَةِ قَالَتْ يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. The pains of childbirth drove her to the trunk of a date palm. She rests by a date palm and then she cries out because of the pain, because of the agony, because of the fact that her people back at home were all talking bad about her. She cries out, Ya laytani mittu qabla hadha wa kuntu nasyan mansiya. Oh, would that I had died before this and that I would have been forgotten and out of sight. Because of all of the pain and the agony, she cried out, you know, cried out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then فَنَادَهَا مِنْ تَحْتِهَا أَلَّا تَحْزَنِي. فَنَادَهَا مِنْ تَحْتِهَا أَلَّا تَحْزَنِي. A voice came from under her. Some scholars, rahimahumullah, state that it was Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam who said this. Some even go on to say that it was Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, her son, who said this. لا تحلا تحزني. Do not grieve. Do not grieve, O Maryam. If it was Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, O my mother, don't grieve. قد جعل ربك تحتك سريا. Your Lord has provided a water stream under you. And then she looks and she sees, because she didn't notice the river at that point, but then she notices that there is a stream, there is a river running beside her. وهزي إليك بجذع النخلة تساقط عليك رطبا جنيا. And shake the trunk of the date palm towards you. Now you might wonder, she's a pregnant lady, how is she going to shake the trunk of a date palm? It's a pretty hefty task. But she didn't have to actually literally shake the trunk of the date palm. She had to just touch it. And then what happened was, fresh ripe dates started to rain down so that she could eat from the dates and so that she could quench her thirst. She gives birth to her child, and obviously, as you all are aware, once a woman gives birth, she loses a lot of strength. She loses a lot of strength. Her bleeding begins. So because of that, she loses a lot of strength. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed her with water and dates. She consumed the dates, she drank the water, and she regains her strength now. She regains her strength. And after that, what she did was, she takes her child, in other words, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. The command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, فَكُلِي وَشْرَبِي وَقَرِّي عَيْنَا. So eat, drink, and be happy. فَإِمَّا تَرَيِنَّ مِنَ الْبَشْرِ أَحَدًا. If you meet anybody, فَقُولِي إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ سَوْمًا فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيًّا. Tell them that I have vowed a fast. I have intended a fast unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I shall not speak to any human being. She was asked to take a fast of silence, a fast of silence, and not to speak to anybody. This was a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what happened was, فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُ. She now goes back to her people with the child, and they all look at her. They all look at her shocked. They look at her and they start, you know, accusing. They say, قَالُوا يَا مَرْيَمْ لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا. You have brought Fariya, something unheard of. We can't believe it. We had such high thoughts about you, and here you are, you're coming with a child. Whose child is this? From where are you coming from? And they, you know, started accusing all kinds of things. They started flinging all kinds of things at her. Ya ukhta Harun, O sister of Harun, ma kana abuki imra'a saw'i wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya. When we say Ya ukhta Harun, it doesn't mean that she was a sister of Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, the brother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is another Harun, a Harun who was a pious man at that time. So she was the sister of Harun. So they address her, O sister of Harun, ma kana abuki imra'a saw'in wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya. Your father was not a man who used to commit adultery, nor was your mother an unchaste woman. We can't believe that you have indulged in something like this. Now what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command her? Not to speak. So what did she do? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She pointed at the child. She pointed at the newborn child, at Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. They looked at her in amazement and said, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. How can the child who's, you know, just a newborn, how can this child speak? So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, did the child speak? What did the child say? Were there other children who spoke during their infancy? All of this, inshallah ta'ala, we will discuss tomorrow. We will try to wrap off the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam as well tomorrow. Tomorrow will be the final session, inshallah ta'ala, for this month of Ramadan. So I look forward to seeing you all tomorrow. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa usalli wa usallimu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen. Nabiyyina wa habibina wa qurrati ayunina Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi afdalu salati wa atamu taslim. Amma ba'd. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Him Azza wa Jal to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, yesterday we spoke about the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. In the sense, we started the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. We spoke about his mother Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, and how Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam, he looked after her. We spoke about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, and the conveyance of glad tidings unto her that she is going to give birth to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And then we also spoke about the birth of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. And we mentioned that the people of the town, they had spread this rumor against Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. They were talking bad about Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. They were talking bad about Al Imran, like we mentioned yesterday. And now she's carrying the newborn baby, i.e. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and as she makes her way to the town, the people, they start hurling accusations at her, you know, they start flinging accusations at her, and they start speaking very harshly to her. And what did we say yesterday? What had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam? Not to talk. She had to keep quiet. So what she did was, we mentioned yesterday that she pointed to the child, and they made a mockery out of it. They said, how can the child speak? You're pointing towards the child. How can the child speak? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the noble Quran, the minute she pointed to the child, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ, the minute she pointed towards the child, and the minute they said, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. How can we talk to a child how can we talk to a newborn child? It's impossible, that's not going to happen. No sooner they said that, this child, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah Azza wa Jal blessed him, he started to speak. قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. He said, I am Abdullah. In the sense, I am a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me kitab, the scripture, and وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا, He has made me a prophet, He has made me a messenger.
وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيًّا.
And then he goes on to say, and he has blessed me wherever I be, and he has enjoined upon me, وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ, he has enjoined, he has prescribed upon me as-salah, was-zakah, and as-zakah, مَا دُمْتُ حَيًّا, as long as I live.
وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَطِيًّا.
And he has made me dutiful. وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي, he has made me dutiful unto my mother.
وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَطِيًّا.
And he has not made me arrogant or doomed for that matter. You know, شَطِيًّا is that he has not made me doomed. Instead, he has made me of those who are blessed. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, an important point to highlight, no sooner Isa والسلام, was born, a great phenomenon takes place all around the planet. All around the planet. So much to the extent that historians mention that all over, idols that were being worshipped in the place of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started to fall one after the other the minute Isa والسلام, was born. Idols all over the place that were being worshipped in place of Allah, you know, in association to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, began to fall all over the place. The devils became perturbed, became disturbed, and they started to wonder as to what was happening. They started to, you know, fly all over the place, and they were being stoned, they were being chased everywhere by the angels, and they wanted to know what is this great event that has taken place to cause such a chain of events. And Shaitan himself, he sends out his minions to go check as to what has happened, go and find out what has happened on earth, you know, on planet earth, to cause about these chain of events. The devils, the shayateen, they fly and they scatter about checking and trying to find out until they reach Baytul Lahm, until they reach Bethlehem, and then they witness the birth of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and they are petrified because this baby is surrounded with so many angels. And in general, what did we say? Shaitan, he goes and literally pinches every newborn child, and that's why the child cries. But now they want to do this same thing to this child because they sense something miraculous surrounding the child. There was this aura of goodness around the child, so they wanted to disturb it, and they wanted to disturb the child. They tried to make advances towards the child, but the angels protected the child, protected Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Why? Because of the dua of not Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, the mother of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. We mentioned the other day, Hannah. What did she say? Inni u'iduha bika wa durriyataha min ash-shaytanir rajim. I seek protection in you, Ya Allah, in regard to her as well as her offspring. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam as well as her son Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. The shayateen, they could not even touch a single hair on the body of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes on to inform the people,
وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ أُبْعَثُ حَيَّا.
And as-salam, may peace be upon me, the day I was born, the day I die, and the day I shall be raised alive, the day I shall be resurrected.
ذَلِكَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and that was Isa, the son of Maryam,
قَوْلَ الْحَقِّ الَّذِي فِيهِ يَمْتَرُونَ.
It was a statement of truth, a clear statement of truth about which they were disputing about. They had doubts in regard to Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. They had doubts in regard to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. This was something that they were disputing about. Now very swiftly, in regard to this miraculous event that took place, what? A newborn baby talking. There are words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam that go to this particular effect. لَمْ يَتَكَلَّمْ فِي الْمَهْدِ إِلَّا ثَلَاثًا. That amongst the children who spoke in their cradle, there were three of them, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to mention them. Isa wa sabiyyun kana fi zamani Juraij. There was a newborn child during the time of an individual by the name Juraij, and also Sabiyun Akhar, that was another young child. So in this particular narration, three children are mentioned. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, we just mentioned his story, in the sense the event that took place when he spoke. And then Sabiyun kana fi zamani Juraij. Now who was Juraij? Very swiftly, Juraij was a very pious worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the time of the Banu Israel. He was an ardent worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the time of Banu Israel. And because of this, he spent most of his time in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to fast. He used to make a lot of dua. He used to spend his time in ibadah. He used to spend a lot of time in ibadah. At a given point, the people of the village, at some point, they started to envy him. A faction of the people of the village, and they started to hatch a plan against him. There was this challenge that came up that no one can, deter or make Juraij waver from his ibadah, from his worship unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, there was this one lady who took up the challenge. Now, why did she take up the challenge? The story along the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions this particular story. Once Juraij was praying, he was in salah, he was praying, okay? And whilst he was praying, his mother called him. Now he was offering a nafil prayer. He was offering an optional prayer. He was in salah and his mother calls him. Now he's in salah and he starts thinking, my prayer or my mother? My prayer or my mother? And he chooses prayer. He ignores his mother. This was day one, day two, day three. This keeps on happening. She comes, she calls. He is in ibadah. He refuses to answer the call of his mother. Instead, he persists in his worship until one day she loses it and she makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, my son, he did not obey me, in the sense he did not answer my call. Let him not die until he sees the faces of the prostitutes. Allahu Akbar. This was a very strong dua that she made against her son. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, and may he help us to treat our parents with excellence upon excellence. Ameen. So what happens after a given period of time? Like I said, this particular lady from the village, she takes up the challenge to try and tempt, to try and seduce Juraij. Now one day she makes her way by the worship area of Juraij. Juraij was in worship. She tried to seduce him, she tried to tempt him. But because he was such an ardent worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not give in to his base lustful desires. No, he chased her away. Now she had to go back to the village and tell them that she had succeeded, because she had taken up the challenge, right? So on her way back to the village, she encountered a shepherd and she indulged in that which is haram, i.e. zina, fornication, adultery with that particular shepherd. After a given period of time, she becomes pregnant. She goes around town telling, this is Juraij, this child belongs to Juraij. This child belongs to Juraij. A lie against Juraij, because she had indulged in that which is haram with a shepherd, not with Juraij, with a shepherd. But she went around town spreading this false rumor that the child belongs to Juraij. Now the people of the village, they respected Juraij, because Juraij was a very righteous individual, a pious individual. The minute this story started making its rounds, they started to feel like Juraij is a hypocrite. He, portrays himself as a very righteous, a very pious individual, but behind our backs he has gone and indulged in that which is haram, i.e. zina, with this particular lady. They get so angry, they get so upset, they go to the worship place of Juraij and they break it into pieces, and they drag Juraij out and start dragging him onto the streets. They drag him onto the streets and they take him past a very shady place. In general, where most of the brothels and most of the prostitutes live. And at that point, whilst Juraij was being dragged out there, there was a big commotion. All the prostitutes come out to look at what's going on. And then Juraij looks up at them and then he realizes. What was it? The dua of his mother. Let my son not die until he looks at the faces of the prostitutes. He is now looking at so many prostitutes and he is in a very humiliated state. They're all looking down at him. What's going on? This man, wasn't he supposed to be a righteous man? Why is he being dragged on the streets? So he was being humiliated. They drag him to a very prominent area in the city, like perhaps the town square or whatever it is, and they start to interrogate and question Juraij. Juraij asks them, what's your problem? Why have you done this to me? I've not done anything wrong. Then they go on to tell him, this lady, she claims that this child is your child. What do you have to say, Juraij? Juraij then prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by the will of Allah azza wa jal, he looks at the child, he actually looks at the newborn child. The child was born at that time, and he asks the child, who is your father? Who is your father?
by the will of Allah, by the permission of Allah, the child articulates words. The child speaks and points to the shepherd, that individual is my father, you are not my father. Now, Juraij was cleared of all of the accusations that they had hurled at him. The people felt so bad because they had dragged a righteous, pious man. They had humiliated him. They had broken down his place of worship. They started to apologize profusely. And then they offer, "Ya Juraij, let us build your place of worship. If you want, we'll build it out of gold and silver. Please forgive us." Juraij says, "Please, I don't need gold and silver. Just build it the way it was, you know, out of mud and straw. That will suffice. And just leave me alone to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." A very righteous individual, but he had to go through that particular fitna, the particular trial, the particular challenge, because of what? He failed in terms of his duty to his mother. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to fulfill our duties and responsibilities towards our parents. Ameen. The other, wasabiyun akhar, another child. This child too was at the time of Banu Israel, a lady. She was nursing her child, she was breastfeeding her little child, when a handsome rider, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions this as well, there was a handsome rider that gallops away while she was breastfeeding her child. The lady looks at that handsome rider with so much of admiration and she says, "How I wish, I pray that my child becomes like that handsome rider." The child takes its mouth away from breastfeeding and looks at the mother and says, the child prays, the child articulates words. It prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Ya Allah, don't make me like that handsome rider. Don't make me like that handsome rider." After a while, a slave woman was being dragged on the streets. People were, you know, beating her, throwing slippers at her. She was being humiliated and dragged on the streets. The mother looks at that lady with so much of worry and she prays, "Ya Allah, don't make my child like this slave woman." The child again takes its mouth away, "Ya Allah, make me like that slave woman." The mother is surprised. She looks at the child, "Child, what are you doing? You said, you prayed to Allah that you don't want to become like the handsome rider, and now you're praying that you want to become like this slave woman." Then the child goes on to explain. The handsome rider who went by, he looks handsome and all, you know, bling bling from out, but in reality, he is a tyrant, an oppressor, someone who has angered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the other hand, the slave woman who is being dragged, she looks humiliated, she looks, you know, in the eyes of the people, they all look down on her, but in reality she has been accused unjustly of theft and fornication. Whilst in reality she is innocent, and no doubt they will, you know, exact retribution, they might punish her, but in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala she is innocent, and because of that she will be rewarded immensely by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I should be like that slave girl. So this is the other child that spoke, a newborn child that spoke according to the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was one more child. This is also mentioned in the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is in regard to the people of the trench. The people of the trench. This is not something that we got to discuss because of lack of time, but inshallah we'll try to touch on it another time, inshallah ta'ala. The people of the trench, during that particular period, what happened was there was a trench dug and there were people being pushed into the trench. There was fire that was filled up in the trench and people were being punished by a tyrant ruler. There was this one lady who was about to be thrown into into that pit of fire, and she kind of hesitated. Why were they being thrown? Because they refused to worship that tyrant ruler. Instead, they opted to worship one Allah. So they were being pushed into the pit as a form of punishment. This lady hesitated because she had a young child with her. And she hesitated a bit because, and you know, her heart kind of wavered a little. That's when the child, you know, encouraged her and pushed her forward. "Ya Ummah, oh my mother, go forward, go forward." This child also spoke, "Because you are on the truth, oh my mother, go forward." So this was the other child that spoke during his infancy, according to the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, quickly getting back to the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, because we have to wrap it off today inshallah ta'ala. From a very young age, there was always something special about Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. There was always something special, and he used to spend time with other children, playing with them and all of that, but there was always this aura of, you know, something miraculous around Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So much to the extent that even at a very small age, he used to inform the children, he used to inform the young children about what they had eaten at home. Now this was something only they knew, but he used to inform them, not that he knew things of the unseen world or that he had access to it, he was informed.
by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that regard, and he used to inform them about what they had eaten. He also used to inform them about the food that they had in stock at home. And they were very amazed, because this was something, no one had access to this kind of information. And they inform, and he informed them about what they had in stock at home. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the noble Quran in this regard, وَرَسُولًا إِلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَنِّي قَدْ جِئْتُكُمْ بِآيَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ أَنِّي يَخْلُقُ لَكُمْ مِنَ الطِّينِ كَهَيْئَةِ الطَّيْرِ فَأَنْفُخُ فِيهِ فَيَكُونُ طَيْرًا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَأُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَسَ وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا تأكلون وما تدخرون في بيوتكم إن في ذلك لآية لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين وأنبئكم بما تأكلون. And I inform you of what you eat, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, obviously by the will of Allah. وَمَا تَدَّخِرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ, and what you store in your houses. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةً لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ, and surely therein is a sign if only you were mu'minun, if only you were to believe. So people were amazed. This started to make its rounds now that Isa, a young boy, he's informing people of things that, you know, only they knew of. He had access to that kind of information. People were amazed. And gradually what happened was this amazement of the Banu Israel transformed in a very bad way into hatred and envy, the Banu Israel. Now they started to plot to kill Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and his beloved mother Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah Azza wa Jal inspires Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam to leave now, because they were plotting to harm them. Allah inspires her to leave with her little son, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and to take refuge in a particular location. وَجَعَلْنَا بْنَ مَرْيَمَ وَأُمَّهُ آيَةً وَآوَيْنَاهُمَا إِلَىٰ رَبْوَةٍ إِلَىٰ رَبْوَةٍ ذَاتِ قَرَارٍ وَمَعِينٍ. We made the son of Maryam, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and his mother as a sign, and we gave them refuge, we gave them protection on a high ground, Rabwa, a place of rest, security, and flowing streams. There were flowing rivers by this particular location. Now, in this particular location, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he started to grow, he started to flower into a handsome, strong youth. And he, being a prophet of Allah, he loved to spend most of his time in seclusion, in deep reflection, thought and prayer. He used to spend most of his time in seclusion. Now one day he passes by a graveyard. He notices a lady weeping. She's crying by a particular grave. He goes by her and he asks her, "Why are you crying?" She says, "I had only one daughter, and that daughter, she passed away, and now I have taken a vow that I will not leave her side until she comes back to life or until I perish here, until I die." Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he looks at her and says, "What if I were to pray to Allah, and if Allah were to give her life, and if she were to talk to you, will you go back home?" To which she says, "O Prophet of Allah, if that happens, I will do it. I will go back if I speak to her and if I hear what she has to say." Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prays to Allah, "Ya Allah, give life to this girl. By your permission, by your will, let her get up." After praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he goes by the grave. He commands the girl, "O young girl, get up by the permission of Allah. Get up by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." The first time he commanded her, nothing happened. The second time, the grave kind of shook. The third time he commanded her, the grave cracked open and this girl gets up. Her hair had all turned grey and white, you know. Her hair had turned, she was a young girl, but her hair had all turned white. The minute she saw her mother, her heart was filled with happiness. The mother was also happy and the mother was rejoicing, trying to talk to her. Then the girl, after talking to her mother, she asked her mother, "Oh my mother, why did you ask the Prophet of Allah to pray to Allah to resurrect me? I don't want to go through sakaras again. That pain is so bad.
that I don't want to ever experience it again. Why did you ask the Prophet of Allah to pray to Allah to resurrect me again? And then Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he asked her, young girl, when I first commanded you by the permission of Allah, why did you not get up? The second time too, you did not get up. You got up only, you stood up only on the third call. Why? Then she went on to explain, well, when you first commanded me to stand up, what happened was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angels to gather my body together. The second time you commanded me, Allah azza wa jal permitted the angels to release my soul back into my body. The third time you commanded me, I heard the grave crack open, and that's when I was able to stand up. Young girl, why is your hair white? She said, I got up thinking that the day of Qiyamah had begun. Allahu Akbar. The fear literally turned my hair white. But then when I got up and saw my mother, and when I saw you, O Prophet of Allah, my heart was at ease. But I don't wish to remain on the face of this earth. Please pray to Allah that I should die, I should pass on to the next world. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays to Allah, and then she goes back into the grave. Now this was a miracle, another sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this news spreads amongst the people as well, and now they come to a conclusion that he is indeed a prophet of Allah. He has been bestowed all kinds of miracles by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what happens is now Isa alayhi salatu wasalam's following starts to grow. There are people who are now believing Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. They start to believe in the message of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Now those who followed Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, they were known as Al-Hawariyun. Allah mentions in the Noble Quran in regard to the Hawariyun, وَإِذْ أَوْحَيْتُ إِلَى الْحَوَارِيِّينَ أَنْ آمِنُوا بِي وَبِرَسُولِي قَالُوا آمَنَّا وَاشْهَدْ بِأَنَّنَا مُسْلِمُونَ. They were the disciples of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the Hawariyun. Allah says, when I, Allah, put in the hearts of Al-Hawariyin, the disciples of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, to believe in me and to believe in his messenger, they started to believe in Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So all of the individuals who believed in Isa alayhi salatu wasalam at that time, they were known as Al-Hawariyun. Why were they known as Al-Hawariyun? Well, the word Hawariyun comes from the sense, the root, similar to Hur'in. It comes from a meaning of whiteness, because one opinion of the historians is that they used to generally dress white. They were always dressed in white. They were very clean individuals who used to dress white most of the time, and that's why they were known as Al-Hawariyun. That's why they were known as Al-Hawariyun. So now his following started to grow. They started to believe in him. That his number, in the sense, his group of followers started to grow rapidly. And at one point, now this group of followers, they had seen so many signs. They had seen so many signs of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, but they were still not content. They asked him, "Oh, Prophet of Allah, we wish to see a very prominent sign. We wish to see a very prominent sign, and we want to see more signs." So Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, we talk about the prominent sign. In regard to the other signs, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah azza wa jalla mentions in the Noble Quran, وَإِذْ تَخْلُقُ مِنَ الطِّينِ كَهَيْئَةِ الطَّيْرِ بِإِذْنِي فَتَنْفَخُ فِيهِ فَتَكُونُ طَيْرًا بِإِذْنِي. What he did was, he made a figure of a bird using clay. He made a figure of a bird and he breathed into it, and by the will of Allah, that piece of clay, it became a live bird and it flew away. This was another sign bestowed upon Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. وَتُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ بِإِذْنِي. He started to cure people who were afflicted with leprosy. People who were born blind, he started to cure them by the permission of Allah, by the will of Allah. He started to cure their leprosy. In general, leprosy was not a disease that they could cure at that time. He cured it by the will of Allah. People who were born blind, he prayed to Allah and they were given sight so that they could see with clarity. These were all miracles bestowed upon Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. وَإِذْ تُخْرِجُ الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِي. He prayed to Allah and he resurrected the dead with the will of Allah, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were many signs, but even after all those signs, the Jews, the Banu Israel, they did not believe in him. The Banu Israel, they did not believe in him. Instead, they started to hate him more and more and more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Noble Quran, وَآتَيْنَا عِيسَى بِنَ مَرْيَمَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ. We gave Isa, the son of Maryam, al-bayyinat, clear signs. وَأَيَّدْنَاهُ بِرُوحِ الْقُدُسِ. And we supported him, we offered him assistance with Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam. Afa kullama ja'akum rasulun bima la tahwa anfusukum mustakbartum fa fariqan kadhabtum wa fariqan taqtulun.
Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks this question, is it that whenever there came to you a messenger with what you yourselves did not desire, because they were still upon the religion of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, even though they had distorted it, they did not like the message that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam came with, so فَفَرِيقًا كَذَّبُتُمْ, and all many other prophets as well, like we mentioned, they killed Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam, Banu Israel, they killed Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. So فَفَرِيقًا كَذَّبَتُمْ, one group of messengers used to deny them, used to belie them, and وَفَرِيقًا تَقُتُلُونَ, and another group of messengers, you yourselves killed them. Allahu Akbar. What great a sin than to kill a messenger of Allah, than to kill a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to kill messengers, they used to kill the prophets of Allah. And as we will discuss, they plotted against Isa alayhi salatu wasalam himself. He kept on persisting in terms of calling them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until one day the Hawariyun, his disciples, they go to him and they ask him, O Prophet of Allah, we want a very prominent, a very manifest sign to be shown to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
إذ قال الحواريون يا عيسى ابن مريم هل يستطيع ربك أن ينزل علينا مائدة من السماء قال اتقوا الله إن كنتم مؤمنين.
They go to Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام and they say, يا عيسى, do you think it's possible for your Lord to send down a table laden with food from the heavens? Is it possible for your Lord to send down a table full of food from the heavens? Is it possible? Isa alayhi salatu wasalam looked at them and said, Ittaqullah, fear Allah and be conscious of Him. In kuntum mu'minin, if you are believers, why are you asking for all these signs? You have seen so many signs. Now why this table laden with food? Then they go on to, you know, put forward excuses. Nuridu an na'kula minha, we want to eat from it, you know, blessed food at the end of the day. Wa tatma'inna qulubuna, yes, we have seen signs, but the minute we see this sign, our hearts will be at ease, we won't have any doubts henceforth. Wa na'lam an qad sadaqtana wa nakuna 'alayha min ash-shahidin, so that, you know, we can be witnesses. They started to make excuses. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he informs them, look, if you are going to ask for a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's going to affect everybody. But they still wanted, they wanted to see the sign. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ اللَّهُمَّ رَبَّنَا أَنزِلْ عَلَيْنَا مَائِدَةً مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ.
He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, send down for us from the heavens a table laden with food. Laden with food. تَكُونُ لَنَا عِيدًا لِأَوَّلِنَا وَآخِرِنَا, so that it will be a festival and a source of sustenance for the first of us as well as the last of us. وَارْزُقْنَا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ, provide us with sustenance, for you are the best of sustainers. Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed a complete surah in the Noble Quran titled as Al-Ma'idah, and this incident is mentioned in Surah Ma'idah as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He answers the dua of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and a table descends. Angels bring down a table laden with food and drink that they had never ever seen. Because where is it coming from? From Jannah. مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. A Jannah, a paradise no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, nor has it crossed the mind of any human being. You can have the most creative, most imaginative mind on earth, and you can imagine Jannah all you want, but know for a fact that Jannah will be a billion times better than that, because it has not crossed the mind of any human being. So food is coming from Jannah, so you can just imagine how tasty and what kind of delicacies must have been on that table. It comes down, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam then looks at them and says, you ask for it, now please partake of the food. There were thousands and thousands of them, but they were so petrified the minute they saw this spectacle that they did not take a step forward. They did not budge an inch because they were scared. They were scared to partake of the food. They were thinking something might happen to us. Most of them did not partake except the poor. The poor and the needy, they jumped forward because they were so hungry. The poor, the weak, the needy, they rushed to the table and they started to eat the food. The rich, the powerful, they stayed behind and they thought, let's see what's happening to them first, and then maybe we'll think about eating.
The poor started to eat. There were individuals who were sick with all kinds of diseases, leprosy, all kinds of diseases, blindness. Some were deaf, some couldn't talk. The minute they consumed that blessed food, all their sicknesses were cured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the minute they finished eating, the table was raised. No one else could eat. This was another great miracle bestowed upon Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. But even after witnessing so many signs, they did not believe in Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. He kept on calling them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His followers started to increase by the day, but the main bulk of them, okay, these the Jews, the Yahud from Banu Israel, they refused to believe in Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. By the day, their hate, animosity, their anger towards him started to increase more and more. And now what they did? They planned against him. They sent word to the neighboring kingdoms, to the neighboring kings. Look, there's this individual by the name of Isa. His band of followers are increasing by the day. And his plan is to usurp all the power that belongs to you all, the neighboring kingdoms. The kings were upset. They all looked at them and said, okay, so what do you propose that we should do? We propose, there's no other solution. You have to put an end to this by killing Isa. Kill him and your kingdoms will be safe. So the kings now all plot together and they decide to kill Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. All of them gather, they all get together to kill Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Now this plan was going on outside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best of planners, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plan, we all plan. وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ. And Allah plans as well. وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. Allah is the best of planners. Allah Azza wa Jal informs Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, إِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى إِنِّي مُتَوَفِّيكَ وَرَافِعُكَ إِلَيَّ وَمُطَهِّرُكَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَجَعِلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوكَ فَوْقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ ثُمَّ إِلَيَّ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَأَحْكُمُ بَيْنَكُمْ فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ فِيهِ تَخْتَلِفُونَ. And remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O Isa, I am going to take you. I will take you and raise you to myself and clear you of all the forged statements that they have raised against you, that for example that you are the son of Allah and whatnot, of those who disbelieve, وَجَعِلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوكَ, and I will make those who follow you, وَجَعِلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوكَ فَوْقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, I will make those who follow you superior to those who disbelieve until the day of Qiyamah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, O Isa, I am going to raise you up to the heavens. I am going to raise you up to the heavens. Now the fateful day arrives, they have all gathered, they're planning, they have plotted to kill Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Now where was Isa alayhi salatu wasalam? We need to get our facts straight. Because some of us, you know, still go with the biblical version of the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. We are Muslims, remember. We are Muslims, we don't go with the biblical version. We go with what the Quran teaches us, what the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us. So let us get our facts straight. A few more minutes, let's focus inshaAllah ta'ala. He was seated in a house. He was seated in a house, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And books of history mention with 12 of his disciples. Who are the disciples? Al-Hawariyun. He was seated with 12 of his disciples. The enemies were hunting far and wide to kill him. They had all plotted. They had come to a conclusion, they are going to kill him. They were hunting all over the city. Where is Isa? Where is Isa? To kill him, to put an end to him. Allahu Akbar. Allah had informed him about this and he was waiting. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. They hunt for him. There was a manhunt going on until finally they find out where he is based, where he is located. They make their way to that house. They make their way to that house and now they knock the door very harshly. They knock the door very harshly. Open the door, we want to come in. Is Isa inside there, alayhi salatu wasalam? Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the minute he heard the knock, he looked at his disciples and he asked them, which one of you is ready to take my place? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make that individual upon my resemblance, which one of you is ready to take my place? I guarantee that individual who takes my place, a close companionship in Jannah, he will be with me in Jannah. The youngest of them all, look, the importance of the youth, the youngsters, the youngest of them all, Allahu Akbar, he gets up and says, O Prophet of Allah, I am ready. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam looks at him, he's young,
very tender age. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam dismisses him and, you know, addresses the crowd again. Which one of you is ready to take my place? Allah will make him resemble me and I guarantee him close companionship in Jannah with me. Which one of you? Again, this youngster gets up and says, O Prophet of Allah, I am ready to take your place. Finally, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam looks at him, he prays for him and says, so be it, you will take my place. No sooner Isa alayhi salatu wasalam said this, the knocking at the door was getting intensified. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed, the roof suddenly caves in, the angels start to descend to lift Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, to raise him up to the heavens. The angels come and they take Isa alayhi salatu wasalam very swiftly. The disciples are all witnessing the Prophet of Allah, their Prophet, is being raised up to the heavens by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No sooner he was raised, the roof goes back to its original position, and this youngster who volunteered to take the place of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam suddenly looked exactly like Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. There was this resemblance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about in regard to that youngster. The people now, they can't take it any longer. They barge into the house, they storm into the house, and they look at this youngster. There he is. Catch him, get a hold of him. They catch him, they drag him out onto the streets, they drag him to a public area, and they kill him in a very painful manner, this particular youngster. Now, the biblical version, they believe Jesus died for us. Jesus was crucified, the cross, all of these things are the biblical version. According to us, Isa, Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, was not killed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he mentioned in the ayah, إِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى إِنِّي مُتَوَفِّيكَ وَرَافِعُكَ إِلَيْكَ. I will raise you, I will take you, I will raise you unto me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised Isa alayhi salatu wasalam up to the heavens. They thought that they had killed Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. They started to rejoice, the Yahud. They started to rejoice, they started to celebrate. We have killed him, we have put an end to his mission, to his propagation. That's it with him. They started to celebrate, but in reality, they hadn't killed him. And he, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, will descend soon by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will wage war against the kuffar, against the disbelievers. And mainly, he will put an end to the leader of them all, Dajjal. He will kill Dajjal. Allah azza wa jal will send him down. By the permission of Allah, he will kill Dajjal. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he makes mention of a narration where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, by the one in whose hand is my soul, definitely the son of Maryam will soon descend amongst you, and he will be a just judge. He will break the cross, he will destroy the cross, he will kill the pig, he will abolish jizya, and wealth will be so abundant that no one will even want to accept it, because there will be so much of wealth, there will be so much of barakah, until a single sajda will be better than the world and all it contains. This particular narration is mentioned in the book of Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. With that, the story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam comes to an end. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I thank you all. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this month of Ramadan from us. Please say Ameen. We ask Him to accept the series from us. We ask Him to accept the time that we spent together for the sake of Allah to discuss the lives of the most beloved of His creation, the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam. Ameen. We ask Him to accept the good that we did during this month in terms of our fasting, salah, sadaqat, recitation of the Quran, seeking of knowledge. We ask Allah azza wa jal to bless us all to attain many more months of Ramadan. As a closing note, I would like to say that if there were any mistakes in what I have conveyed unto you, because after all we are human beings, we are prone to err, if I have made any mistakes, know for a fact that the mistakes are from me and from Shaitan. And all of which was correct and upright, which I, you know, forwarded to you, is solely from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should forgive all of our sins, accept our good deeds, and just as how He kept uniting us every single day, may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah. I thank you all for coming almost every single day and being a part of this event. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should bless us with more opportunities, that we unite for His sake, that we meet in the future as well. And I profess my sincere love. I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakum Allah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.